they're reading.
You read?
Just lay it on your thing.
When do I start?
Throw it at your thing.
No, this, yes, I knew about this since Wednesday.
All good.
Good morning. Among the persecuted, among the privileged, Christ is coming to make all things new.
In a private house, in a public place.
Christ is coming to make all things new.
With a gentle touch, with an angry word.
With a clear conscience, with a clear love. Christ is coming to make all things new.
That the kingdom might come, that the world might believe.
That the powerful might stumble, that the hidden might be seen. Christ is coming to make all things new.
Within us, without us, behind us, before us.
In this time and every place, for this time, for all time, Christ is coming to make all things new.
Please join us in our opening hymn, Waymaker.
I worship you.
God, we gladly say, goodness
is stronger than evil, love is stronger than hate, life is stronger than darkness, truth is stronger than lies.
Because confusion can reign inside us despite our faith, because anger, tension, bitterness, and envy distort our vision, because our minds sometimes worry small things out of proportion, because we do not always get it right, we want to believe.
Goodness is stronger than evil. Love is stronger than hate. Light is stronger than the darkness. Truth is stronger than lies.
Because you have promised to hear us and are able to change us, and are willing to make our hearts your home, we ask you to confront, control, forgive, and encourage us as you know best. Then let us cherish in our hearts that which we proclaim with our lips.
Goodness is stronger than evil. Love is stronger than hate. Light is stronger than darkness. Truth is stronger than lies.
Lord, hear our prayer and change our lives until we illustrate the grace of the God who makes all things new.
Amen.
I now invite Corporal Carter Ryan to come forward for our first reading.
When you requested of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, and you said, if I hear the voice of my Lord, my God, at Horeb, or ever again see this great fire, I will die. And the Lord replied to me, they are right in what they have said. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among your own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet, who shall speak to them everything that I command. Anyone who does not heed the words that the prophet shall speak in my name, I myself will hold accountable. To any prophet who speaks to me of other gods, or who presumes to speak in my name a word that I have not commanded the prophet to speak, that prophet shall die. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in assembly of the upright, the congregation. The great deeds of the Lord, they are studied by all who delight in them.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
His work, his full majesty, and splendor of man is righteous and is forever. He makes his marvelous work to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
He gives his food to those who fear him. He is ever mindful of his covenant. He has shown his people the power of his works in giving them the lands of his nation.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
The works of his hand are faithfulness and all justice. All his commands sure. They stand fast forever and ever, because they are done in truth and equality.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
He sent redemption to his people. He commanded his covenant forever, holy and awesome in
You just wanted your picture taken.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Now, concerning food sacrificed to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Anyone who claims to know something does not yet have the necessary knowledge, but anyone who loves God is known by him. Hence, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that no idol in the world really exists, and that there is no God but one. Indeed, even though there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as in fact there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things. And even though whom we exist, it is not everyone, however, who has this knowledge, since some have become so accustomed to idols until now, they still think of the food they eat as food offered to another, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not bring us close to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if others see you, who possess knowledge, eating in the temple of an idol, might they not, since their conscience is weak, be encouraged to the point of eating food sacrificed to idols. So by your knowledge, those weak believers for whom Christ died are destroyed. But when you are thus sinned against members of your family and wound their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food is a cause of their falling, I will never eat meat so that I may not cause one of them to fall. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. But Jesus rebuked him, saying, be silent and come out of him. And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. And they were all amazed. And they kept on asking one another, what is this, a new teaching with authority? And he commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey. And at once his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding regions of Galilee. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
Please be seated. In our Gospel reading today, we hear about Jesus being confronted by an unclean spirit in the synagogue. What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us, we hear the Spirit say. This passage can cause us to ask many questions. Was the man really possessed by an unclean spirit? Is there any such thing as being possessed? And do we really believe that this happened? I think we can get sometimes too wrapped up in questions like that. And I believe that we can miss probably the bigger message that the writer is trying to convey to us. The first of that is being that sometimes people are spiritually unwell. We allow unclean spirits to affect us, how we act, how we live, what we say. And it can affect how we have an encounter with God. So maybe we need to name some of the obstacles, some of the things that get in our way, affects our spiritual lives. And maybe once we're named, maybe we can tell those things to just go and leave us alone, so we can be the people who God calls us to be. So the first one I'd like to name is unbelief. That's a big one. Losing one's faith in God. In life, as a sacred force that runs through all living beings, losing our faith in our fellow human beings, that each and every one of us contains the presence of God. Each and every one of us is sacred and holy. The second I'd like to name is hopelessness. The feeling that nothing can be done to solve our problems. The feeling that we're stuck in this state of darkness, and that we believe that the world is beyond help, beyond repair, and we have nothing to look forward to. And the third I'd like to name is belief systems that create that illusion of separation, that creates hate between people who are not like them. Systems such as homophobia, sexism, classism, religion and intolerance, violence at home and in schools, poverty, and terrorism, and greed and war, and globalization and out of control capitalism, and the fear that exists in us sometimes that leads to paranoia and think that everyone is against us. All of these are unclean spirits that can live within us and separate us from God and one another. But they can only separate us if we let it. They can only be successful if we give it authority and give it a place in our lives. Jesus, in the Gospel writer, tells us today, talk with authority. We don't know exactly what Jesus said that day in the temple that made the writer say that, but I'm willing to bet that his teachings didn't stray far from the teachings that are in the rest of the Bible. His teachings are life-giving and shows us what it means to be truly human. First, we know Jesus had a relationship with God. Anybody here feel like they have a relationship with God? I do too. I find God is always with me, and he's always listening to me, no matter where I am. He's in this building, but you know what? He's also in your homes. He's in your schools. He's on the streets. Jesus is with us wherever we go. He's in our hearts, yeah. That's really wise words this morning. Thank you for sharing that with me. Jesus is in our hearts. And he wants us to remember that God is always with us. And Jesus set an example of how to begin that. Because you know how Jesus started his day? He started his day with prayer. Because his days were pretty busy. He had to go all around and deliver the message of God wherever he went. So he got up really early. He went to a quiet place and he prayed. And he talked to God and he listened for what God was going to say to him. And God would speak to his heart. And you know, God also speaks to our hearts. And just as God recentered Jesus when he got wrapped up in the busyness, God can recenter us and bring us back to that place of love, which is, pardon? We all love God, Jesus. And when we love God, we love each other, right? Yeah. Because we got to see that God exists in each and every person. So we can't really love, say we love God and don't love the person next to us, right? Yeah. So we got to love everybody. And that's God's love flowing through us. The second thing is that Jesus brought hope to the people. He brought hope with encouraging words and told them that the future was going to get better. He told them not to focus too much on negative things. I know he said, don't worry about tomorrow. You know, don't worry about tomorrow, just focus on today. And tomorrow will take care of itself. You worry about that when you get there. Pardon? Focus on the good things, right? I should have you up preaching this morning. You're very intelligent. Sure, she knows the gospel. She is good. I contribute that to hopefully your, is that your parents or who taught you all about God? Yeah? You have some good teachers in your life. I'm really happy for that. Jesus always told us to forgive one another. You know, not to hold on to that bitterness inside because, you know, that really squashes our spirits. That can be like an unclean spirit that lives within us if we can't forgive. Because if we can't forgive, we can't grow. We're stuck. We're stuck in our tracks. Always tells us that. And also Jesus said that death is not the end of our lives. As sad as it is, you know, to lose someone we love, we can still live in that hope that someday we're going to see them again. Because Jesus came back in the resurrection and told us, or showed us, that there is life after death. Life continues on. And the third thing I think he attempted to do was break down those invisible walls. You know those walls that we don't see, but we kind of know that they're there? Jesus broke down the walls, or attempted to break down the walls between the rich and the poor, between the Jews and the Samaritans, between the men and the women, between the people who were sick and the people who were healthy. He tried to open everyone's eyes to the value that existed in each and every person. Jesus spoke with authority, and his authority was from God. And it was God himself speaking to us, telling us exactly how to live. But Jesus' teaching only have authority in our lives if we let it. If we follow the words that he told us, if we allow his words to become our words, if we allow his actions to become our actions. And I know that sometimes that is really hard. I know, imagine as kids, sometimes you struggle with that. I know adults that struggle with that. They struggle following the way of Jesus. They struggle following the way of love. And anything is possible, it is. We just need to give our hearts to God. It's simple. And to get out of our heads with all these things that we have, like I said, unclean spirits that separate us from one another. We've got to get out of our heads and into our hearts. And when we do that, you know, anything is possible. but a love that flows through each and every one of you, every single day, because God's love flows through us. Yeah. When we give them love, we get love back.
Yeah.
We get happier. I know I get happier. I'm a lot happier when I'm loving someone. Because when I'm hating someone, I'm like a closed fist. But when I love someone, I'm like so open up. And the joy just comes out of my heart. Yeah. Do everybody feel love when they give love to one another? Do your heart feel right open? Yeah. And that's the way God wants us to live. That is the perfect way to live, for sure. I know in our archdeaconry here, or should Trent, go back a little bit. Transforming discipleship is one of the goals that we have set in our diocese for 2024, transforming discipleship. And what that means is focusing on living the way of Jesus, focusing on living the way of love. And this year, this is much of a coincidence that Ash Wednesday actually falls on February 14th. What's February 14th? Valentine's Day, yes. So Ash Wednesday is also Valentine's Day. So how appropriate is this year that we're going to use the way of love as a resource to guide us through Lent? And each week we're going to focus on a different practice. And we're going to get together with our neighboring parishes, and we're all going to work together to study the way of love, that we can be a more loving community. We can reach out to our neighbors and get to know each other and deepen the relationships. And then we can take these activities that we're already doing sometimes, because we're all Christians. We all know how to follow Jesus. And there's probably lots of good things we're already doing. But we can acknowledge what we're already doing and put that into our rule of life so that we know that we are living the way of love now. And we can pick out some new practices so that we can continue to live the way of love in the future. And we can be God's hands and feet. Anyone here like to be God's hands and feet? I do. I love to be God's hands and feet. That's right. You don't need a card. All you need is love. You take that love and you share it. And that's the most important thing. So thank you. I'm going to ask you your name. What's your name? Elsie? Well, thank you very much, Elsie, for helping me with my sermon this morning. Because there's a lot of love flowing you through you, for sure. It is a very blessing to me to have you here this morning and to be a part of our worshiping community. So right now we're going to proceed with our CLB enrollment. And one of the things with the CLB is looking for the authority that God has in your life and giving God authority in your life. Because there's a lot of things that try to take control of our lives. Sometimes it's our feelings and our emotions. Sometimes it's our friends and things they might tell us to do. Sometimes it could be television or like certain social media influencers or something that might try to tell us to live a different way. But living the way of Jesus is living the way of love. And we need to put that as our top priority and give Jesus authority in our lives. So I think, hopefully, all the adults in the congregation got all that message this morning too, because if we don't give Jesus the authority in our lives, who are we following? What are we doing if we're not following Jesus' way of love? Very important thing in it. What are we doing if we're not following Jesus' way of love? So I'm going to come down now, and then we're going to proceed with our CLB enrollment. That's right. Help everybody. Now, we have to ask the leadership and the CLB to come to give us a hand and direct us. And who's getting enrolled this year? instructed in the CLB brigade prayer and the object of the brigade. So now I have questions for the candidates, and I'll let you know if the answer is I will, okay? So we need you to all say and read it out when it comes to I will, okay? Will you try to do your duty to God and to be loyal to the King? I will. Will you agree to keep all the rules and the regulations of the CLB and to be loyal to your officers and those set in authority over you and to obey cheerfully all their lawful commands? Will you be a credit to the brigade and will you treat your fellow brigade members with kindness and consideration? Will you try to be clean in thought and word and deed? And will you be proud of your uniform and never bring disgrace to it by behaving badly in it? So, fight under his banner.
Let us pray. Holy God, though this world depends on your grace, it is governed and tended by mortals. So we pray for those who walk in the corridors of power, in the parliaments of this and other lands, whose judgments we value or fear. May they always consider those they represent, make decisions that with integrity, and resist any temptation to abuse the trust placed in them.
Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for those who hold key positions in the worlds of finance, business, and industry, whose decisions may profit some or impoverish many. May they always value people higher than profit. May they never impose burdens on the poor, which they would never carry themselves. Excuse me. And may they never divorce money from mortality or ownership from stewardship.
Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for those in the caring professions who look after and listen to kind, cruel, and contemptuous folk. For those who make decisions regarding nations' health and welfare. May they always sense the sanctity of life and every person's uniqueness. May they help and heal by their interest as well as their skill. And may they be saved from tiredness and the excess of demands.
Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us.
Let us remember those for whom we are responsible and to whom we are accountable in what we do today.
Lord,
may we show them the thoughtfulness, tolerance, and kindness of Jesus.
Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us.
Lord, hear our prayers. And if today we might be the means by which you answer the prayers of others, then may you find us neither deaf nor defiant, but keen to fulfill your purpose for Jesus' sake.
Amen.
Spirit.
Renew us for your service.
We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord.
Christ, you make all things new.
Transform the poverty of our nature by the riches of your grace, and the renewal of our lives may know your glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Any other birthdays in the congregation? No birthdays this week? love them all. So I know for a lot of the younger members, you're probably too young yet, but if music is your talent, let us know. It might be something that you can do in the future also. God bless you all. I hope that you all have a really wonderful week. Anyone has a birthday that they're afraid to say, well, happy birthday to you too. And we're going to begin now with Refuge leading us to sing happy birthday.
Jesus, now lead on.
Because good things have been prepared for for those who love God.
Jesus, now lead on.
God bless you all. Go in peace, the love, and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.